In 1982, Tobe Hooper's poltergeist, German for nosy ghost, haunted the screens. It's rumored that he wasn't actually the main director, but only on set as producer Steven Spielberg, at the time working on E.T., which was released a week later, wasn't officially allowed to direct two projects at the same time. I never had any doubt that it was a typical Spielberg movie. This was reinforced by the fact that in early copies the words "a Steven Spielberg production" were written larger in the credits than "a Tobe Hooper film," which was excluded from the editing process, which also applied to the rest of post-production, etc. The almost $11 million US film was a huge commercial and critical success, grossed more than 10 times as much worldwide, and has so far received two sequels and a remake. The 1996 TV series has, apart from the name, nothing to do with the features. The so-called Poltergeist Curse, four actors died in the course of the first three movies, was a widespread myth at that time. However, the sequels actually suffer from the Halloween curse, fearlessly exposed and irrevocably proven in the same-named documentaries, where each movie is not as good as the last, but at least not quite as awful as the next. Successful estate agent Stephen Freeling lives with his family in a suburban housing estate under construction. After an earthquake, confined to his home, furniture suddenly begins to shift on its own. The mother notices more and more strange phenomena in connection with her daughter and the house. During a storm, a tree grabs son Robbie, while a gateway opens into another dimension in which her youngest daughter Carol Ann disappears. A team of parapsychologists called in to help soon find themselves overwhelmed by the supernatural events, which is why they turn to a medium to bring back their daughter, who has been contacting them via TV since. The suitable eerie soundtrack is by Jerry Goldsmith, who also scored Part 2. Part 3 is by Joe Renzetti. Poltergeist bears similarities to a very good episode from the 1960s series Twilight Zone, based on a short story by Richard Matheson, among others author of The Incredible Shrinking Man and I Am Legend, which can be found in the Quiet Earth Rare View.
He also wrote the screenplay for the two Kolchak movies, Cub.
I know. You already mentioned that in the Quiet Earth review.
But where can people watch it?
Glad you asked, Greg. At least someone who cares.
I'm just reading your stupid lines, Cub.
Whatever.
Based on currently still uncensored platforms like my Telegram, BitChute or Odyssey channels. Also called the Lone Wolf Cup, and in the original German version, Der Japango. Since on Fascist Tube on the English channel already deleted because of alleged medical misinformation. With, in best 1984 manner and under disregard of the human rights, simultaneous threat of a channel deletion, Gestapo style. If I dare to continue to draw attention to the scientifically proven harmfulness of the gay slave masts, and the also, even in the mainstream media itself, confirmed lethality of the so-called vaccinations, aka untested gene manipulating poison injections, carried out by physicians with zero empathy inspired by Mengele, covered by the bought and synchronized media inspired by Goebbels, and unpunished by the obviously once again, but I would say still, by nepotism enforced authorities completely corrupt to the bone. Since YouTube, as a part of Google, is one of the companies making record profits from the pandemic while all the others go bankrupt, which means of course these companies are the ones responsible for the corona scam, it tries like any criminal organization to cover up its crimes, and therefore deletes each channel or censors every video which could contribute to clarify the case. In Little Girl Lost, the titular character also disappears into another dimension, whereupon her parents try to find her and finally bring her back through a rescue mission. Parodied in the iconic Homer Cubic segment from Simpsons Treehouse of Horrors 6. The classic among the poltergeist movies is a very well cast, perfectly staged, if you can overlook a few implausibilities. So the daughter disappears and they sort it out without police. None of the neighbors seem to notice anything. The medium contradicts her own rules that Carol Ann supposedly only hears her mother. They stay in the house for a while after the rescue so that the grand final can happen, etc. Nevertheless, still an extremely entertaining ghost story with spectacular effects for the time. The many practical ones, in particular, even some CGI, are still impressive today. The movie has quite rightly achieved its cult status. Especially because of the extremely likable characters the audience is able to connect with and an interesting story that clearly sets it apart from similar movies. Many of the elements, such as the ghostly communication through the TV static, the eerie closet or the imploding house in the final, but especially the resolution that the estate is located in an old cemetery where the dead bodies were not moved to save costs, found their way into pop culture and have been constantly copied or quoted ever since. In 1986, Brian Gibson's Poltergeist 2 takes us to the other side. A year after the first movie, the family, with the exception of daughter Dana, actress Dominique Dunn was murdered in 1982, are living practically penniless with their grandmother. The insurance company refuses to pay for their missing house and the father works as a vacuum cleaner salesman. After medium Tangina finds clues in a cave where the old house stood that evil is haunting the Freelings, she sends Native American shaman Taylor to help them. Repeatedly, a strange preacher appears who seems to be after Carol Ann. And once again, a demonic entity enters their house as a poltergeist. Although the movie was a commercial success and made worldwide almost four times the $19 million budget back, it fell well short of part one. And quite rightly received mostly negative reviews. Poltergeist 2, The Lamer Side, although the director was also excluded from the final cut, for sure isn't accused by anyone that Spielberg maybe has directed or even kept an eye on it. In some scenes, especially in the final, they had to shoot without the preacher actor Julian Beck, as he died before end of production. It was initially supposed to be in 3D, as the scene with the flying chainsaw, but they dropped the idea. After disastrous test screenings, the studio ordered extensive post-production, which included cutting it down from 130 to 91 minutes. And the uninteresting plot still crawls at a snail's pace. It is a typical, far too late, hastily written, delayed sequel to a story that was actually finished. Much like Ghostbusters 2 later on. Unnecessarily complicates the origin story. The desecrated cemetery is of course not enough. The old house is now suddenly located above a cult burial site. And apart from a few nice effects, the braces of horror, the monster tequila worm, and the excellent, completely wasted Jerry Goldsmith score, it can't for a second keep up with the predecessor. Nevertheless, the story about preacher poltergeist Reverend Kane is still Citizen Kane compared to the next turd. In 1988, Gary Sherman's Total Catastrophe Poltergeist 3 shows us, at least according to the German poster, the dark side of evil in a supermodern, extremely mirrored skyscraper. There once was a time. Carol Ann's parents sent her for reasons to the Gardners, her mother's sister, and their teenage daughter Donna, which don't believe in the ghost stories and even think the Freelings are crazy. But the ghost of Reverend Kane follows the little girl and finds enough access to our world in the cracked mirror surfaces, thanks to the mirror and ghost rule 5743, entry through mirror brain cracks. He now suddenly wants to be let into the light. Even though all the events in the first two movies took place because the Beast expressly refused to go into the light. Carol Ann now also goes for reasons to a school for the gifted and has to, and here too no idea why, visit a shrink who doesn't believe in ghosts either and even wants to convince her otherwise. Donna, because of her boyfriend, simply steals away while babysitting. With a master key from her father, who happens to be the architect of the building, to party with some teens in the shadow of her parents' big exhibition cocktail party in the rest of the building. So why should I care if somebody let you in? However, she and boyfriend end up like the abandoned cousin in the puddle of horror. That's nothing new. I know just what that can mean. And appear from now on as fakes, luring others into the trap. Meanwhile, medium Tangina, no sign of her Indian colleague, as Taylor actor Samson died after the last movie, is on the way, taken out directly by fake Carol Ann. Only to appear later as ghost to help the aunt against replacement Reverend Kane. The original actor died during the last movie in the grand final. The third part made at around $10 million budget just $14 million in the US back, making it a flop, and was, keeping with the crumbling mirrors, largely crushed by critics. Like part 2, Poltergeist 3, The Dull Side of Stupid had disastrous test screenings and got therefore, among others, not that it would have done any good, this thing couldn't be saved, a new ending, in which the Carol Ann actress, who died unexpectedly shortly after the regular shooting at the age of only 12, was replaced by a double. The scenes from the original final, with the prisoners as ice figures, were eventually released as unedited bonus material. There are various fan original ending reconstruction attempts on the net. According to some involved, they were literally forced by the studio to reshoot the scenes, as director Sherman no longer wanted to finish the project after Heather O'Rourke's death. Which were then so carelessly shot, among others, a plot-relevant character, precisely Don's boyfriend Scott, who thanks to the reshoots didn't make it back and is presumably still waiting on the other side to be rescued, was simply forgotten. You can also forget this so-called movie. Poltergeist 2 and a half, only half of everything, except for a few good mirror effects and a nice score by Joe Ransetti, Jerry Goldsmith was too expensive, simply rehashes the already completely uninteresting story about the evil Reverend and Kane in worse, but this time with only half as much money, half as good a script, and I'm being merciful here, 120 words alone are just the name Carol Ann, with which the viewer is bombarded throughout, and not even half as many original actors. In 2015, Jill Keenan's Poltergeist remake haunted screens and was immediately forgotten. This time a family, the father lost his job, so they had to move, gets hold of a cheap home in a bleak suburban housing estate. At a diner with friends, they find out that it was built on a former cemetery. When their youngest is the first to notice that something is wrong with the new house, no one wants to listen. Only when the little daughter is abducted by her imaginary friends, the lost people, into another dimension, do they turn to parapsychologists for help. Now someone has also to go into the strange dimension to bring her back. In the process, they also get told that the bodies from the former cemetery were not reburied, in a throwaway line by the TV ghost hunter who was brought in to replace Tangina. Much like the show magician replacement for the Peter Vincent character in the also completely unnecessary Fright Night remake crap from 2011. Poltergeist 2015 edition made on an estimated $35 million budget just $47 million in the US back, plus the same amount worldwide, so it wasn't a flop but certainly not a hit either, and received quite rightly mixed to negative feedback. Since entire dialogues, plot points or scenes from the original in a supposedly more modern setting, flat screen smartphones, ghost hunter reality shows, camera drones are simply ticked off point by point like on a shopping list. There are also references to the sequels, like with the daughter which falls into the puddle of horror as in part 3, or a rotating tool attack in 3D as in part 2. At one point, a face is disfigured in a reflection as seen in the first, only this time from the father, which in the original was the top estate agent and therefore a direct profiteer of his company immoral settlement construction. But now that they have turned him into a wishy-washy unemployed loser, since there can't be any strong male characters in modern movies anymore, the ghosts in this version have no real motive to terrorize especially this family. Further downgrades are also the parapsychologist and her smart-ass troop, her ex-slash-medium replacement whatever, and on the fact that this thing is slow as hell without any surprises and zero suspense, with horribly fake-looking CGI, I won't even start.